The inline 3 seems to be the new inline 4. In recent years, we have seen this humble little 3-cylinder engine configuration become ever more widespread. A 1-liter inline 3 together with a turbocharger has managed to replace 1.6 or even 2-liter inline 4s on many cars. And this really isn't surprising when we take into account the kind of efficiency and emission standards that car manufacturers have to meet nowadays. An inline 3 has less cylinders and therefore less friction and thus more efficiency. It's also obviously more cost effective to manufacture due to the reduced number of parts, plus it's easier to package due to the reduced overall length of the engine. But when it comes to motorcycles, an inline 3 tells a different story. It of course isn't considered downsizing because bikes on average have less cylinders than cars. So instead, the inline 3 is some sort of oddball luxury in the world of motorcycles. Over the years, there have been some truly impressive and iconic inline 3 bikes, and there are some interesting benefits that this engine offers for a motorcycle, but despite all of this, the configuration remains uncommon when it comes to bikes. Now, one of the companies that has definitely done their part in increasing the percentage of inline 3 motorcycles on the market is Triumph, and in today's video, we'll see how their innovative T-plane inline 3 engine abandons decades of design logic to try and create an engine with a split personality. We'll also compare the T-plane inline 3 to other inline 3s out there, for example to Yamaha's Crossplane inline 3, and yes, you'll also learn why I'm rolling my eyes when I say the word Crossplane right before the words inline and 3. So, let's go. Now, if we take a circle, which is obviously 360 degrees, and divide that circle into three equal parts, we'll see that each of these parts has 120 degrees. This very simple geometric exercise lies at the very core of the design philosophy of the inline 3. And in fact, if we take an inline 3 engine crankshaft and look at it from its nose, so straight on, we'll see that the crankshaft kind of looks like our geometric exercise. Each crank pin is 120 degrees apart from one of the other two crank pins. This means that every 120 degrees of rotation, we have a piston coming up to top dead center and being ready for combustion. But the fact that a piston is ready for combustion doesn't mean that it can achieve combustion. And this is because a four-stroke engine needs 720 degrees to complete a single combustion event. So we need 180 degrees for intake, 180 degrees for compression, 180 degrees for combustion, and 180 degrees for exhaust, giving us 720 in total. And if we take that and divide it by 3, which is the number of cylinders, we get 240. And this tells us that the inline 3 fires every 240 degrees of engine rotation, we get a combustion event. And this means that we have an even firing interval. There's always the same number of degrees between each combustion event. Now, achieving an even firing interval is extremely important for the inline 3 engine because this engine has a problem with primary balance. And if we had an uneven firing interval together with bad primary balance, the engine would actually be too rough for some applications. If we compare the inline 3 with the inline 4, we can see that in an inline 4, we have two pistons going up and two pistons going down. When a piston moves towards top or bottom dead center and then changes direction, it exerts an inertial force in the direction in which it was traveling before it was forced to change direction by the connecting rod. So in the inline 4, we have two forces pointing up and two forces pointing down. And so they cancel each other out, leading to perfect primary balance. To get a better understanding of primary balance, it sometimes helps to observe it on a graph. So our horizontal axis is engine rotation, and our vertical axis is our force magnitude. And as you would expect, the force peaks at the top and bottom dead center where the piston achieved greatest acceleration and deceleration. Now, if we assign each piston a different color circle, we can see that in the inline 4, piston pairs generate forces of equal magnitude but opposite direction. And so the forces cancel out. Now, when it comes to traditional inline 3s, we have two different crankshaft configuration options. If we observe the engine in respect to engine rotation, then option 1 is to have crank pin 1 and crank pin 2 be 240 degrees apart, and crank pin 1 and crank pin 3 120 degrees apart. Option two is this flipped over, the opposite of this. This, of course, leads to different firing orders for the two different configuration possibilities, but we have the same firing interval. So the engine fires every 240 degrees of rotation, and we have 60 degrees of silence between the combustion events. In other words, we do not have a power stroke overlap. And because we have the same firing interval for both of the configurations, we also have the same sound characteristics. And also, regardless of which configuration we choose, when piston one is at top dead center, the other two pistons will be 120 degrees before and 120 degrees after top dead center. Once we take things to the graph, the difference between the two configurations becomes completely non-existent. So here we have piston one at top dead center. One of the other two pistons is 120 degrees before top dead center, and the other one is 120 degrees after top dead center. As you can see, we can change around the piston numbering labels, but the balance remains identical for both engine configurations. What's interesting is that observing from the graph alone, the inline 3 also appears to have perfect primary balance. We can see that the primary forces of pistons 2 and 3 sum up and equal the force of piston 1. So again, we have forces of equal magnitude and opposite direction, which leads us to believe that we have perfect primary balance. But if we transfer what we have learned from the graph onto the engine, the problem becomes apparent. The forces may be equal in magnitude and opposite in direction, but they are also separated by a perpendicular distance, which means that they create a rocking couple. We can easily visualize the effects of a rocking couple using our fingers and a rectangular object. If we apply forces of equal magnitude but opposite direction onto an object, the object stays in place. But if we put a perpendicular distance between the two forces, the object now rotates. This is exactly what a rocking couple is trying to do to the engine as it's running. It's constantly trying to rotate the engine front to back, leading to undesirable vibrations or even potential engine damage. Things are especially difficult in an inline 3 because the center of rotation of the rocking couple also changes location as the engine is running. A rocking couple like this must be eliminated in the interest of user comfort, engine longevity, and the longevity and operation of other associated components. In an engine with an odd number of cylinders, the only way to get rid of a rocking couple like this is to use balancing shafts or offset weight flywheels and crank pulleys together with clever engine mount designs. So the inline 4 beats the inline 3 when it comes to primary balance, but the inline 3 beats the inline 4 when it comes to secondary balance. Well, it only sort of beats it. Now, when it comes to secondary balance, I really won't be explaining it again in this video. I've done it far too many times in my previous videos. So what I'll do is that I'll just add the force curve onto the graph that we're already using, because this really is all we need to understand secondary imbalances for the purposes of this video. If you want to know about why the curve looks like this, what is the source of secondary imbalances and vibrations, then I'll put up links in the suggested video corner of this video, as well as down in the description, so you can check those out if you're interested. Now, when it comes to secondary balance, the key thing we have to understand is that unlike primary balances and imbalances and forces which point up at top dead center and down at bottom dead center, secondary forces point up both at top and bottom dead center, and they point down only at 90 and 270 degrees of rotation. This means that whenever a piston is coming to a stop and changing direction, secondary forces point up. If we observe the inline 4, we can see that all four pistons are coming to a stop and changing direction at the same time. So all four forces point up, leading to noticeable secondary vibrations, which shake the engine up and down as the inline 4 is running. Now, as we know, in the inline 3, when the first piston is at top dead center, the other two will be 120 degrees before and 120 degrees after top dead center. This means that again we have the same situation as with primary forces, a rocking couple. But as you can see, secondary forces are much smaller in magnitude, which means that the resultant couples will also be weak. When we also factor in the shortness of the inline 3 and thus a very small perpendicular distance between forces, the resultant secondary vibrations become barely noticeable and don't require a balancing shaft. So when we sum everything up, the traditional inline 3 is a humble engine, but it's a good deal. It may be overall less smooth than an inline 4 due to a larger gap between power pulses and overall worse primary balance, but it makes up for it by being more cost-effective, more compact, and more efficient. Despite this, Triumph chose to reject the good deal offered by a traditional inline 3, and they decided to upend the design logic of this engine. Instead of having the crank pins evenly spaced out at 120 degrees from each other, they separated them by 90 degrees, creating a configuration which looks like the letter T when viewed from the nose of the crank, hence the name T-Plane Inline 3 engine. Of course, having the crank pins 90 degrees apart means that our even firing interval goes out the window. Instead of firing the engine every 240 degrees of rotation, the T-plane has an uneven firing interval where we fire cylinder 1, rotate 180 degrees, fire cylinder 3, then rotate 270 degrees, fire cylinder 2, and then again 270 degrees to fire cylinder 1 again, giving us a firing interval of 180, 270, 270, and a firing order of 1, 3, 2. So why would Triumph choose to take an engine that is barely smooth enough for some applications and make it even less smooth by employing an uneven firing interval? Well, there are two main reasons behind this. And the first one is that an uneven firing interval gives the engine a distinctive sound character, which helps set it apart from the competition. Let's compare the sounds. A specific recognizable soundtrack can give the engine a unique character, and this can boost sales. It certainly worked for Yamaha and their Crossplane Inline 4, which sounds completely different from all the other mass-produced inline 4s. In fact, this worked so well for Yamaha that they tried to forcefully trickle down the word crossplane into their engine offerings with less cylinders, calling their inline 2 CP2 and their inline 3 engines CP3, the CP being crossplane. Now, calling a inline 4 crossplane definitely makes sense because all the other inline 4s are flat plane. All their crank pins lie in one single plane. But a inline 3 is crossplane by design. Yamaha's CP3 engine is just like any other inline 3 out there. It has 120 degrees of separation between the crank pins, and it has an even firing interval. Calling a inline 3 crossplane is redundant because the three planes in which the three crank pins lie cross each other anyway. It's the very nature of the, you know, traditional design of this engine to be crossplane. Calling it inline 3 crossplane is like calling chocolate pudding CP chocolate pudding, in order to distinguish it from all the other chocolate puddings on the market. And CP here stands for chocolate pudding. It's redundant because chocolate pudding is chocolate pudding by its very nature. Now, I'm not saying that the Yamaha bikes are bad or the engines, they're really good, but the deal is that the word crossplane really doesn't make sense because all the other inline 3s on the market are also crossplane. This is an obvious attempt of marketing and branding, which I completely understand from a different perspective. You know, the point is to try and associate the lower priced bikes with the much more upmarket R1 and the MT10 motorcycles. Now, realistically, the word crossplane is only distinguishing Yamaha against just one old bike, and that is the 1976 to 1981 La Verda Jota. This is the only example of a mass-produced flat-point inline 3 that I know of. If you know of any others, comment section. So we have two pistons up and one piston down in inline 3, giving us a flat single-point inline 3. The result is an uneven everything, which is why Jota abandoned this design as well and went for a conventional 120 degrees inline 3 starting with 1982. We'll be right back. But a unique sound character isn't the only reason why Triumph went with an uneven firing interval. Uneven firing intervals have been used for a long time in motorcycles to help improve traction. An uneven firing interval creates a larger gap between power pulses coming from the engine to the rear tire. These gaps are also known as recovery gaps, and if these gaps are large enough in higher gears, they can even allow the tire to roll a full footprint without a single power pulse. This allows the tire to relax and restore its original form, which prevents a loss of traction that might otherwise occur if the tire was subjected to a constant barrage of power pulses. This is why motorcycles that are expected to see a lot of off-road duty are usually two cylinders or less, whereas dirt bikes and enduros are exclusively single cylinder. The less cylinders we have, the greater the gap between power pulses. Obviously, with three cylinders, the Tiger is at a disadvantage in the dirt and doesn't have the kind of gaps that a single or twin do. So Triumph rearranged the crank pins to increase the gaps naturally present in the inline three. As we can see, a traditional even firing inline 3 already has a gap of 60 degrees between power pulses. The T-plane rearranges this, and by deleting one gap, it creates two gaps of 90 degrees. This is obviously still less of a gap than a single or twin, but that's okay. Nobody really expects the Tiger to compete with dirt bikes. It's an adventure motorcycle that aims to be good off-road and great on-road. The 50% increase in power pulse gap is just enough to create an improvement in a low RPM off-road traction and throttle control, an improvement that riders can actually notice and make use of. So the gap is big enough to be noticeable at low RPM off-road riding, but it's also small enough to become unnoticeable at mid and especially high RPM asphalt riding. As the RPMs increase, the gap sort of disappears and the bike still largely feels as smooth as a traditional triple on paved roads. A number of motorcycle journalists definitely noticed this and praised the new engine for having a sort of split personality. It feels a bit like a twin at low RPM and a traditional triple at mid and high RPM. So what Triumph managed to do is give the motorcycle a distinctive sound character together with improved off-road traction while maintaining on-road smoothness and power delivery. The only price they paid for it is slightly increased vibrations, which a motorcycle rider usually won't mind anyway. Now, I got a lot of comments in my Crossplane Inline 4 video from people saying that they would love to see a Crossplane Inline 4 in a car because it sounds like a mini V8. Now, before some people start commenting on this video how they would love to see a T-plane Inline 3 in a car, let me tell you that neither of these engines is going to happen because both of these engines give you the downside of increased vibrations due to an uneven firing interval without the upside of improved traction because cars simply don't face the same traction challenges as motorcycles because cars have four wheels. Also, no car manufacturer is going to invest the incredible amount of engineering needed to make a totally novel engine happen. And then, you know, just for the sake of the sound, which would in the end be largely diluted thanks to all the sound insulation, catalytic converters, resonators, and mufflers present on modern cars. But what about primary and secondary balance? Well, when it comes to primary balance, we again have a problem, but just a slightly different problem. So piston 1 is at top dead center, piston 3 is at bottom dead center, and the middle piston is mid-stroke. If we put this on our graph, we can see that again, we have forces of equal magnitude, opposite direction, and perpendicular distance between them, so we have a rocking couple. The only difference is that this time around, the problem is a bit less complex because the center of the rocking couple doesn't move as the engine is running. It always stays at the middle of cylinder 2. However, this advantage is offset by a bit of a disadvantage because our perpendicular distance is a bit larger in the case of the T-plane, so the rocking couple is in theory a bit greater, but I doubt that in practice it's very noticeable at all, and I doubt that any additional engineering efforts were needed to get this out of the engine because an inline 3 needs a balance shaft anyway, and the T-plane also needs a balance shaft, so overall the primary balance of the T-plane is almost the same as the primary balance of a conventional inline 3. When it comes to secondary balance, we have two forces pointing up and one force pointing down. The two forces of opposite direction, equal magnitude, cancel out, and it leaves us with one secondary force at one end of the engine, and it's shifting from one end of the engine to the other as the engine is running. Now, in theory, this is even weaker and less noticeable than the already barely noticeable secondary rocking couple present in a conventional inline 3 engine. However, we never really had a noticeable problem with secondary balance in the first place, so this slight improvement of secondary balance with the T-plane goes largely unnoticed. And there you have it. That's pretty much it for today. Definitely a really innovative approach to an inline three-cylinder engine from Triumph, an approach which manages to cleverly sacrifice low-priority traits in order to seize high-priority benefits. As always, thanks a lot for watching, and I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4A channel.